We won't deny it. Break me apart, I need you to pierce through the dark and cleanse every part of me. So
I want to cry before I get to even start praying, man. What's up with that? You know what? For me, and once again, I show my age when I make statements like this, but legacy matters. It matters a lot. And you know, I know the kids, I'm going to dismiss you in just a minute. I can see the ants moving. But, you know, having a legacy in a church, Providence, you know, you want to be a part of that legacy, this is what it looks like. We need you to teach and help us grow a family. And as we grow a family, they begin to serve in church, they begin to work in church, because old guys like me have to move on. And, you know, we step to the side and have people come in and take over and do the work of the Lord. And, man, I know Michelle and them, they do a wonderful job with all of this, yes. Man. And I know Mike and those guys are teaching, you know, training their kids and the things of the Lord and worship like that. But we need you to help us do this job. And so if you ever, if this inspired you to get involved and be a part of what you saw in the video or any of that, please don't hesitate. Follow the touch of the Lord and work on that. And man, we'll be praying for you and getting you involved in this. And there's a process to it, but see Michelle, see me, we'll get you plugged in, man. We'd love you to be part of leaving a legacy and teaching and working with youth and adults for that matter. But God is good, isn't he? All of you children, stand up. If you signed up for children's church, man, you're ready to go. Yeah.
They'll work cheaper.
They will. Phil, I always got something to say back, but I have to be careful, so. God is good, isn't he? I love his faithfulness. One of the phrases in the song, it says that I may fail, but my God never will. He's faithful to his word. He's faithful to those who love him and serve him. And man, I love the phrasing of some of the songs that we sang, and especially hearing our young people sing that. Man, what an amazing, if you can feel that and get in that. Man, God is going to do some amazing things here at Providence and through our people and through our kids. But will you join me in prayer this morning? Father, I love you. And you deserve our praise this morning. Thank you for a group of young people, Lord, who are willing to take their talents, Lord, and lead us in worship. What an amazing sight, amazing thought that is. I pray that you will continue to keep your hand upon them. Lord, there are others who left this room just a minute ago that are smaller and all of that. And I pray that as we continue to honor you with our teaching and the things that we do, that you would just raise up amazing leaders. Whether they're teachers in the elementary or in the public system, or whether, Lord, whether they're doctors and lawyers and all that, may they always honor you with what they do, that your name would be lifted up above all names. Thank you for what you are doing. Lord, thank you for yesterday and all the fun and the different things that we had. May we continue to be a light in this neighborhood. Help us to touch and reach and minister to each and every one. Lord, we are thankful for those who will be giving towards the different opportunities that we have coming up. Lord, thank you for the Adopt a Family and the Matthew Project. And Lord, just thank you for people who are supporting Providence Church. Lord, without your faithfulness through them, Lord, I don't know where we would be, but you are good. And Lord, we just want to give back to you what's already yours. Thank you for that. Lord, I pray for Greg this morning. I know he has a tough act to follow, but I pray that you will just continue to use him and that your word would come alive into our hearts today. Thank you for what it's going to do in our lives. We need you. This culture, this world needs a church who will stand on the word of God and help us be that light, that beacon in this area. God, we need your help. We need your strength. We need all that you are going to do through us. Take our talents, take all that we are, and we will be thankful with all that you have placed in our hands. And we'll give you honor and praise. In your wonderful name we pray. Will you join me in the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. And give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Amen. God bless you, Providence.
All right. right, all right, all right. Good morning, good morning, good morning. Good things are happening. If I've not met you, my name is Greg. I'm lead pastor here at Providence. As you can imagine, it's a pretty good day for me so far this morning, isn't it? You know, just watching what God is doing. I'm so glad that you're part of that. Providence Church has six core biblical values that we have tried to build this church on. We saw the intersection of two of those this morning. One of those is passionate worship, that we believe part of being a Providence Church is that we learn to worship our Lord through word, through prayer, and through song, lifting up his great name. One of those other core values is children, youth, and families. So this will always be a church that is not only welcoming to the young, but training the young to lead. You saw both those come together this morning. Isn't that kind of cool? So it's exciting. And it wasn't on purpose, but God and his sovereign timing is so cool, because on the exact moment that we are in Colossians, we're really starting to turn towards what does a Christian family look like? All this kind of stuff just sort of pieced together. You can't make this stuff up. God is the one who does that. So our scripture reading this morning is from the book of Colossians, where we've been for several weeks now. Colossians chapter 3, verses 18 to 21. God's word. That means something. It means it's inspired. It means it's inerrant. It means it's infallible. It means that our lives submit to God's word. We don't change God's word to fit what we want it. And so we receive it as such. Colossians chapter 3, starting at verse 18. Wives, submit to your husbands as is fitting to the Lord. Husbands, love your wives. Do not be harsh with them. Children, obey your parents in everything, for this pleases the Lord. Fathers, do not provoke your children, lest they become discouraged. All right, let's pray. Holy Spirit, if there was ever a time in your history where we need to hear from you, It is in matters of Christian families. And so, Lord God, I pray this morning that you make us teachable, that you make us moldable, that, God, you would do your amazing work, that you would carve these truths on our hearts, that when we leave here today, we leave and we live like they matter. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, this morning we are going to start with a little trivia. How does that sound? Now, no, we haven't done this since we were in the older building. I wasn't sure if this would happen or not because it's a much bigger group, but I think it is going to happen, okay? So here's how we're gonna play this morning. I'm gonna put the picture of a famous TV family on the screen. It is your task to tell me the name of that family. Not the name of the show, the name of the what? The family. And by the end, we will know who watches too much TV. Okay? All right. No, we want you to play. Some of these are quite older. So some of you young families are going to be like, I've never even seen that before. Okay, so some of you are about to give away your age also. Okay, here we go. Ready? First one. The Clampets, right? The Beverly Hillbillies straight in from Brooksville. Okay, all right. That's a joke. I love Brooksville. I was thinking more like Homosassa. Okay, all right. The Flintstones. Now, for extra credit, they're best friends. All right, man, you guys are on it. Okay, all right. Next, the Jetsons. Okay, man, you guys are 3 for 3. All right, next. What? Who said gun? Safety team, fourth row back. Okay. The Hex is from a show called The Middle from the 1990s. All right, so you guys know your cartoons. Okay, next. Adam's Family. Isn't that right? Okay, good. You guys knew that one right away. Okay, next. Everybody over 60 just said it. All right. The Nelsons, right? From the show The Adventures of Ozzie and Harriet. Okay, ready. Next. That's the name of the show. The Walker, the Evans. All right. Y'all knew the show though. You're like, good times. All right, awesome. Okay, next. The Cunninghams, only one person out there got that. Who called it? All right, I'm impressed. All right, very good. All right, two more, ready? The Keatons, that is correct. Josh, you just gave the answer to his wife. Okay, I saw that, Josh. You know, that was sweet of you. Okay, last but not least, the Cleavers, right? Leave It to Beaver. That's actually Tony and Michael Heald when they were young. And no, oh, all right. You know, well, you guys know your TV families, but you know, when we turn the TV off, we move away from the fun of what we watch on the screen. I'm making a striking observation here. Families are a mess. Maybe not yours. In fact, I pray it's not yours. But family systems are a wreck. Spent 2 decades plus in student ministry. Been a teacher. Mental health counselor for adolescents. And a pastor, lead pastor for the last almost 12 years. And do you know what I've learned? Families, they're a mess. Husbands and wives, trying to figure out what life looks like in marriage, dealing with their children. It's different. Everybody has their stuff. Don't misunderstand me. I mean, everybody has their stuff. If anybody hears this morning is like, oh, I've got this figured out perfectly, you are lying in church. I'm talking about the stuff, though, when I say the mess. I fear that there's something much more sinister on a much grander scale that we're dealing with when it comes to children and families. And yet, why should we be surprised? Why should we be surprised? Because we look at the theological basis of this. We have to remember there's a thing called sin. Everybody is born with it. And so often we talk about life, what happens is we seem to divorce this idea of sin from just our regular life. But the reality is that sin has impacted families. That husbands are sinners and wives are sinners. Now get ready to get mad at me. Children are what? Sinners. And so you have to look, I mean, we don't have time to like do a whole survey of it, but if you look into scripture, my heavens, it started in the beginning, right? Adam and Eve are hanging out and everything is good. They sin. Adam's like, she did it. Right. They have 2 sons. One kills the other. Abraham comes along, breaks God's design, decides he wants to have a couple of wives, where he has to end up kicking one of them and their child out of the house at some point. Fast forward many, many years later, there's Jacob. He has a whole bunch of sons, but all the sons decide to take one of the younger brothers and throw them into a pit. You think you're going to have a bad Thanksgiving? Try that one. Sold them off into slavery. You think you're dysfunctional. David had all kinds of family dysfunction. We didn't even have time to go into that. Eli parented 2 sons as a high religious figure who were absolute total train wrecks, and I'm just scratching the surface. So what we see in the context of redemptive history is, yes, sin impacts families. Because when we don't live according to God's design, bad things happen. And I'm not an alarmist. And I'm certainly, if you know me, for those of you who are regular attenders here, I'm not into cultural exegesis, but I think it's getting worse. Because now to deal with the dysfunction in our families, we're just changing the definitions. I mean, our culture has come to a place now where let's just change the definition of marriage. I mean, it's not that we weren't already a mess following God's design. Now let's just move the goalpost. And let's change the definition of marriage to something that is completely so far away from not only the scope of thousands of years of human history, but from the scripture itself. And it's worth noting that within 10 years of changing the definition of marriage, our culture has now changed the definition of gender. See, because the more you move from God's design, the more you will continue to slide from God's what? Design. But what are the practical consequences of that? The practical consequences is, how does that impact our families? What does that mean for us today? Well, the good news is the scripture speaks into this. The scripture, in many places, we're just going to take a look because we're in the Colossians series, but the scripture speaks into what are families? What do husbands do? And what do wives do? And what are the responsibilities to their children? And don't get too excited. You all, the Bible's not going to tell you what time your high schooler should come home from prom. And man is not going to tell you if you should buy a gift card, flowers, or a blender for Christmas this year. It's not going to get that specific. But what it is going to do is going to lay bedrock foundational principles that are rooted in God's word, what family life can look like. See, and here's how this works out. Because if you've been tracking with us through Colossians, and if not, I'm so glad that you came, you have to understand the thesis and the argument of the book of Colossians, that Christ is first, that Jesus is supreme, that Jesus, Colossians has told us, is a sustainer of all things. And in fact, Jesus is preeminent in all things. And so we know that because the author, Paul, in Colossians, makes a case for that. And so much so that he says, listen, this has been proved by the fact that you were once in darkness. You were in a dominion of darkness. Nothing was good happening in your life, and yet Jesus rescued you from that darkness and brought you into the kingdom of light. And he continues to warn. He says, but be careful, watch out, because there's a lot of empty philosophy, and there's a lot of teaching out there that is not raising up Christ as supreme. Does that sound familiar? And we told you a couple of weeks ago that as we come to chapter 3 then, we hit this hinge where this beautiful theology, if Jesus is supreme, if Jesus is preeminent, in other words, if you're here this morning and you would say, I'm a believer, Greg, and I'm going to amen that, Christ is first, then what does life begin to look like? And we talked about then there are some things we have to take off in our lives. There's things that we need to put on in our lives. And we definitely need to take our mind and we need to learn to set it where? Above and not here. But here's what you need to know this morning, Providence Church. If Christ is first, which is the argument of the book of Colossians, if Jesus is preeminent in all things, that means that he is also preeminent in the most intimate relationships in your life, which include the home, husbands and wives, and how you deal with your children. Because you can't divorce the two. This is the struggle in the church oftentimes. As we go through the scripture, we say, I like this, and I like this, and I like this, and then we come to passages that step on our practicalities, and then we bristle, and we tense up. Well, my friends, if Christ is first, Christ is what? First. If Christ is preeminent and sustainer of all things, then that includes under your roof. So what does that look like? Well, we can't do a complete look at this because the job of the pastor is to teach what's in front of us. So there are some things this morning that are going to be left unsaid. Time and responsibility to the text doesn't allow us to drift far out of it. But for our purposes, let's look at what Paul was saying to this group because there's some things here that we need to know. Number one, verse 18, wives submit to your husbands as is fitting to the Lord. And at this point, all the husbands are secretly going, amen, Greg, preach it. I didn't hear that right. Would you say it again? One more time. And now all the wives are already mad at me. But the problem with this passage comes down to definitions. It's actually quite sad, really, that the word submission has such a negative connotation. That is because we have allowed our culture to import a definition apart from the scriptural's definition. So my job for you this morning, hopefully, is to clear that up. And we'll have to be fast. Some things will be left unsaid. But it's important to understand what submission is not. Submission is not being subject to a tyrant. Submission is not putting up with and dealing with a violent or otherwise oppressive husband. Submission is not being treated like a slave or a footstool. Submission is not serving your husband without restraint. Submission is not smiling and dealing with somebody walking around the house righteously saying, I'm in charge, I'm in charge, I'm in charge. Man, if you have to say you're in charge, you're not. That's not submission. Submission does not mean inferiority. It never has. See, in the Greek, the word submission, it's a military term. It means to willingly put yourself under, to arrange under a rank. It has never implied inferiority. In fact, Galatians chapter 3 sort of just clears this whole thing up. There is neither Jew nor Greek, slave nor free, male nor female. You are all one in Christ Jesus. So submission has never, ever, at any point in history, ever been meant to be inferior. However, all because we are one in Christ and nobody is inferior does not mean that our roles are removed. Submission has to do with living in the roles God has gifted us with in those places that God has put us. A sergeant is not inferior to a captain. They are equal in value, but they are different in what? Roles. And why does that happen in the military? It happens in the military because you have to have order. Because if you don't have order, you are going to have what? Chaos. And I would boldly submit to you this morning that a family needs order. Because if a family does not have order, then a family will have what? Chaos. See, that's part of the challenge here. So when we talk about submission, it's about order. It's about cooperation. It's about relationship. It's about partnership. It's about a husband and wife walking together through life. It's about wives willingly submitting. You can't force it. You can't make it. That's never going to happen. But the problem is we have too many homes where the wife is trying to be domineering and the husband is trying to be domineering, and there's this thing that begins to happen, and it bleeds down to the kids, and it creates all kinds of disorder, and is just not what Christian marriage is. But see, what's crazy, and we don't have time to work out all the theology of this, but really the submission that a wife is called for in the scripture is a submission that the Lord Jesus showed God the Father. I mean, remember the Trinity, right? God the Father, God the Son, God the what? The Holy Ghost. Jesus was never inferior to God. But Jesus, God made man, willingly what? Submitted, joyfully submitted to God the Father, which maybe is why the scripture says, back there we just read, wives, submit to your husbands as is fitting to the Lord. And that's a deep theology, and that's a deep dive. But maybe there's someone sitting here this morning, maybe there's a wife sitting here this morning, and they're like, Greg, I hear you, I'm struggling with this. I want to be that kind of person, but my husband, he doesn't want to be a spiritual leader in my house. My husband won't even get off the couch. What am I supposed to do if my husband just doesn't care about these things? And I think the Bible speaks to that. You pray for him, you love him, you gently encourage him in those roles, but you don't nag. You don't attack self-esteem. You don't insult. If you want to see everything that's wrong with marriage, go stand in Walmart for an hour. You laugh. Watch how husbands and wives speak to one another. I told you this several years ago, but you forgot. I saw a woman in Walmart one time slap her husband over a box of Cheerios. And I thought, man, if that's in the Walmart cereal aisle, what does your living room look like? First Peter chapter 3, wives, in the same way, be submissive to your husbands so that if they do not believe the word, they'll be won over without words by the behavior of their wives when they see their purity and reverence of your lives. Side note, young ladies, listen to me if you're unmarried. This passage matters to you. Because if this is your calling, you better be seriously careful about who you marry. You better think closely. You get that? Oh, husbands, you're in trouble now. Verse 19, husbands, love your wives and don't be harsh with them. So easy for us to read this. I'm like, oh, of course, what's the big deal? History matters. This would have rocked the ancient world. I would love to have been a fly on the wall when this was read in the Colossian church, and then when it circulated to the other churches, which we know historically, that's what gives a canonicity of these letters as they were circulating around. This would have rocked the ancient world, and here's why. See, in Jewish thought, women were a possession. In ancient Jewish thought, a wife was, well, it was like something that you owned. So therefore, it had no legal rights. For example, a Jewish husband could divorce his wife for any reason whatsoever. But a Jewish wife cannot divorce her husband unless he got leprosy or he assaulted an unmarried woman. That was it. The Greeks weren't much different. The wives in Greek society were respectable women who had to live entire seclusion. They didn't appear on the streets alone unless they were with somebody. They weren't invited to the meals with the men. They stayed in their own areas. Complete servitude and chastity were required. The Greek man could have as many extramarital affairs as he wanted to with no social consequences. But the woman was not allowed to do that. So the Christian teaching comes along. And Paul says, husbands, love your wives and don't be harsh with them. But now if Paul, track with me now, if Paul used the Greek word eros, everybody would have celebrated. Because eros was the word for intimacy. So if Paul was saying, hey, husbands, be intimate with your wives, they would have been like, yeah. But he uses the word agape, which is different. See, our English translates them all the same, but there are several words for love in the Greek. This word's agape, which means sacrificial. In other words, Paul was saying, husbands, love your wives sacrificially. Husbands, love your wives as in you will put yourself last. You see how that would have rocked the world? Husbands, love your wives in such a way that you would die for them. So when the Bible says, husbands, love your wives, it goes so much beyond that. This is about absolute, I put my wife first in all things. It is the same word that is used when Jesus said, for God so loved the what? The world, that he gave his only begotten son. It is a kind of sacrificial, lay it all out there. I don't matter. You're the one that matters. Husbands, that is the love that you are called to have for your wives. And it's expounded here in Ephesians chapter 5. Husbands, love your wives just as Christ loved the church. That's a sacrifice. The church being the people He gave himself up for her, cleansing her by the washing in water through the word to present her to himself as a radiant church without sin. Husbands ought to love their wives as their own body. He who loves his wife loves himself. Men, hear me. When you are struggling with your wife, love your wife. You took a vow. You stood before man and God and said, I do. And I do means what? I do. And that scripture calls us to that. You know, you're supposed to love your wife. You're supposed to lead. The burden is on you. There are four super important things that need to be said that, and this is such a weird message, it's just like four side notes, but they're not side notes and they're not important, but they just burn my heart this week. I want to make sure I point those out, then we'll talk about the kiddos, then we're gonna pray. Side note number one. When marriage does not work correctly, everything else becomes distorted. Church, strong homes make strong churches. Strong homes make strong schools. Strong homes make strong communities. Strong homes make strong corporations. Strong homes make strong governments. Strong homes make strong nations. And apart from that, everything fractures. Number two, have realistic expectations. I think the number one issue we have in marriage is we have wrong expectations. You married a sinner. And I think too often that we think marriage is like a Hallmark movie. In fact, do yourself a favor. Just turn the Hallmark channel off. I'm about to do you a huge favor. I'm going to tell you how every Hallmark movie ends. Are you ready? Yes, the handsome guy, slightly unshaven, tall, dark, super rich, owns a Mediterranean restaurant in downtown New York City, gets the girl, the beautiful blonde girl who lives on a farm in the country and raises horses and llamas. He does get her. Somewhere in the movie, they're going to have one little fight. You'll be on the edge of your seat with a box of Kleenex thinking that all is lost, but do not fret because he is going to propose. It's probably going to be on Christmas Eve with a light snow falling and Christmas lights in the back of the ground. She is going to say yes. He's going to keep an apartment in the city. They're going to buy the farm of the dreams in the country. The end. You're welcome. Look how much time I just saved you. And if life was only a Hallmark movie, but it's not. We have to monitor our expectations. People stumble and fall and have good days and bad days. And we have to extend grace to them. Number three, this is a can of worms. I have to say it, but it's for a different day, but it has to be said this morning. Your family system growing up has played a significant role in how you view marriage. Your family of origin story has deeply impacted how you see marriage and children. If you are in a second marriage this morning, whatever happened to you in your life before, whatever that is, has deeply impacted how you see marriage. And that is why we have to renew our minds. That is why we have to take the good, whatever it was, and I pray there was all good for you growing up. I don't know your story. I don't need to know your story. But there's good, but you got to come to the place in your life where you realize that you are a new creature in Christ that resets your mind so that you do this stuff the way God calls you to do it and not the way grandma calls you to do it. We love grandma. But we want God's way, yes? If you've struggled with this, get some help. We'd love to pray with you. We'd love to sit down with you. We'd love to spend some time with you in this area. Lastly, side note, and then we're gonna finish up talking about the kiddos. In singleness, Jesus' love is still supreme. I'm afraid sometime when we have messages like this that there are some of you trying to raise your kids on your own, you're like, man, I'm mom and dad. There are some of you who have not found Mr. or Mrs. Wright yet. You're in different places in life, and I don't know what's going on in your heart. And it's so easy to sit in a day like today and want to wrestle with this, but you need to hear me and talk to a guy who didn't get married until he was 29. Let me just make that clear. In your singleness, Jesus' love for you is as absolutely supreme as it has ever, ever, ever been. Do you get that this morning? And glory in that, and work in that, and bathe in that, and live in that, and know that beautiful truth. Okay, finally, and we don't have time really to do much here, so I'm just gonna scratch the surface on a topic I'm actually a bit passionate about, but verse 20. Children, obey your parents in the Lord, and what? Everything. For this pleases the Lord. Our youngest children have left the room. We only go up to third grade in children's church, fourth grade, fifth grade, middle schooler, high schoolers. Give me your undivided attention for a moment. The Bible has called you to obey your parents in everything. And the beauty of this passage, young people, is this. You have to understand, when you do that, you are the one who gets blessed. See, you're the one. Your parents look like they're blessed because you're like, yay, they're obeying. But in the long term, young people, you are the ones who get blessed. You are the one who God honors in this. And I realize and I understand that the growing up process is difficult. I know it's hard, and I know sometimes it seems unfair, and you just think that your parents is there to make your life miserable, and they might be for right now to keep you from something you don't even know about. But the Bible doesn't say it'll be easy. It just says to what? Do it. But parents, it always strikes me when we make kids memorize the scripture when you're the ones who need to memorize it. This was written in the Colossian church, all the families, but do you know who needs to know the scripture? You. And here's why. Because it is your job to train your children in obedience. That is your job. It is your job to go through the difficult, painstaking, horrible process of teaching your children to obey. And that means there are going to be days that your kids are not going to like you. But the Bible never says, thou shalt be my child's friend. Never has it said that. And I would add to that one more thing, because we have so many young families here. Let me just tell you, what is cute at 4 years old is not cute at 14 years old. So obedience better start, and it better start now. There's many loving ways that we can do that, but you are called to do it. Parents, hear my heart. You are called to give your children what they need, not what they want. Because what they need is what they want. They just don't know it yet. That's your job. The worst theology shows up in parenting. I had a lady in my office one day when I was a youth pastor, and she said this to me, if there was ever an angel on earth, it is my daughter. I thought I'd throw up in my mouth. The tension is this, we desperately love our children. Desperately love our children. I do. You do. but your children are sinners. I'm sorry you feel that way. I'm sorry, baby. I know I'm scary. But it's true. I was teaching sixth grade one time at a private school, and I was in a small portable where the kids were kind of all put together. It was fun teaching sixth grade because they never had a male teacher before, so for the first week, their eyes were about this big, you know. And I can remember I was doing a spelling test early on, and I told the kids, get out a cover sheet, because they were so close together. And one of the boys kind of lamented. He was just one of those guys. And he's like, well, Mr. Gunn, you don't trust us. And I just kind of said, I trust y'all. I just don't trust your sin nature. Next day, some little sixth grade girl with a big pink bow on her hair came marching in, and she put down a note on my desk. She said, this is from my mom. Like third week of school. You know, I was like, oh, great. You want to be here for 3 weeks. And open it. Please do not refer to my daughter as a sinner ever again. We laugh. I get it. I really don't want to get a note from one of my kids, from the teacher. But look, you are called to train your children to what? Obey. Because left to themselves, they what? They won't. And if you don't teach them to obey at home, they're not going to do it at school. There was a day where if you got in trouble at school, you got in trouble at home. Those days apparently are gone. Somebody comes home and they say, I got in trouble with the teacher. Well, Mama Bear is on the loose. I'm going to go talk to the principal and the teacher. I'm going to call my state senator. You might want to find out. Maybe your kid was disobedient. If they don't learn to obey at school, they're not going to obey in the community. They're not going to obey as adults, and I tell you what, they're not going to obey God, because you will not obey authority. You cannot see. If you cannot obey authority, you can see. As we close up, I just want to say this to you. You guys who are new to it are like, man, he's intense. Not really. He just came at a fun day, but maybe God brought you here for a reason this morning. I'm going to be the first to tell you I don't have all this figured out. My wife Amy and I make no claims to knowing how to deal with this kind of stuff. I promise you, listen to me. I'm not posturing for you. I am a gravely inadequate husband. And I'm a gravely inadequate parent. I don't like this stuff because it makes me come across like I've got to figure it out. I'm still raising kids like you are. The jury is still out. So maybe it just comes down to choices. See, the choice that Amy and I made as we were getting married was really the challenge of Joshua 24. Remember, Joshua at the end of his life pulls everybody together and just presents to them two choices. Let me take you way back to the valley that day. As Joshua speaks, now therefore fear the Lord and serve him in sincerity and faithfulness. Put away the gods that your father served beyond the river and in Egypt and serve the Lord. And if it's evil in your eyes to serve the Lord, choose this day whom you will serve. Were the gods your father served in the region beyond the river, or the gods of the Amorites in whose land you dwell? But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. The crossroads this morning really is simple. We will serve the Lord and build a Christian home, albeit imperfectly. We'll identify with the gods across the river, which today is the culture that's outside of this building right now, but the choice is before you. I was out running last night trying to go through my message and de-escalate, and frankly, God laid something on my heart, and I don't think we've ever done this in 11 years of Providence Church, but I feel strongly we need to do it this morning. If you were here this morning and you would say, Greg, I accept this challenge. Our family, albeit imperfect, like yours, Greg, is going to serve the Lord. If that's you, I'm going to ask you to stand this morning because I want to pray with you. If you're that person this morning and you're just like, and maybe you're single and you're like, you know what? Someday when I'm at that place, I'm gonna serve the Lord. If you're raising kids on your own right now and you say, I gotta do it both ways, I'm gonna serve the Lord. And don't stand because someone beside you is standing. But if you're like, I want to be that person, albeit imperfectly, then I wanna pray for you this morning. What an amazing church this is right now. Let's talk to God, Father in heaven. Thank you for the boldness of those who have stood, but Lord, more than those who stand, God, you know everybody's hearts here. And so, Lord, for those standing or sitting here, we're just saying, God, our family's going to serve the Lord, and we're not going to get it right, but we've seen the scripture, and we're going to try to live that way, and oh God, would your Holy Spirit just bless their house right now? God, would you just put a wave over them? And Lord, would you guard them from the enemy? Because there's a moment in crossroads like this where the enemy is busy, busy, busy. So God, we pray that Satan is far away from this place, that is far away from families, that are far away from homes, that God, you will be our refuge, that you will be our fortress, that you will be the cleft in the rock, that you will be the God on high, and you'll protect everybody that's here this morning. God bless them. Strengthen them for the work. Give them what they need. And Father, may they look back maybe even on this day and say there's a moment in our lives where we said, we will serve the Lord. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen.
And they For 'twas on that old cross Jesus suffered and died to pardon and sanctify me. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will quit.